Generation X describes those born between 1965 and 1979, which currently places them in their early 40s to mid-50s. This is the generation that witnessed the introduction of computers in schools and homes and really became the first generation to experience working parents and higher rates of divorce. Termed the latch-key kids and the home alone generation, as a result, they developed independence, flexibility, and a peer-oriented mindset. Gen X, like their non-descript label, have an understated visibility in society, but bring massive influence economically, demographically, politically, and organisationally. They are the generation at the peak of their leadership and impact. So joining me today to discuss our latest research about this generation is social researcher and demographer Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thank you, Ashley. Good to be with you.
We have just released this report about the different generations, which we've titled The Generations Defined. And in it, we take a deep dive into each generation. And we've inserted in this report, as you know, Mark, a few different quotes about each generation and the changing times. And I wanted to read one to you and then get your feedback on it. So one of the quotes we've included says, "Every generation creates change, but occasionally the times and trends collide and a generation has enormous impact and shapes the culture beyond all measure. The boomers experienced it in the 1960s, their children, Gen Y, saw it in the early 2000s, and now it seems as though their grandchildren, Generation Alpha, are at the forefront of another such transition." So beautiful quote, very empowering, but there's a generation in there that we've kind of skipped over. Well, there's a couple actually that we've skipped over, one of which is Gen X. And as this quote suggests, we do often talk about those transformative decades or that decade of the 1960s that the baby boomers kind of lived through and saw. And then we talk about the 90s and the early 2000s with technology. But in between all of this, we have Gen X, who often get a little bit left out of the equation. Now, as a social researcher, Mark, but also as the person who gave Generation Alpha their label and as a Gen X yourself, how do you feel about all of this with Gen X being a little bit forgotten about?
missing, as always, overlooked and understated. Yes, that's Gen X. I think it is the case. You know, it is a bit of a middle child generation. You know, we've heard for decades about the baby boomers. We've seen their impacts. We've heard for decades now about millennials, and even, you know, the very descriptive label there defines something of the coming of age era of that particular impacting generation. And in the middle is Generation X, that a lot of people are even unsure where did they start and end and exactly who are Generation X, where did it all come from. So I think that is the case. It's a generation that really is fitting in between two iconic generations and does tend to lie pretty low. In fact, those born from about 1960 to about 1964, 1965, because we say, you know, Gen X is 1965 to 1979. So the first half of the 1960s, they definitely don't connect with the baby boomers. They can't remember any of the big revolutions of the 60s. They were just being born into it. And so they're fully a missing generation. They normally identify themselves more with Gen X than the baby boomers, even though officially we would sort of say that X's begin from 1965. So it's just highlighting the point that not only is Gen X a bit of a grey generation, a bit nondescript, a good proportion that are just prior to them are the lost generation that exist in the gaps and aren't really seen at all. So yeah, I think it's a true reality sociologically that the Gen Xers have slipped between the cracks.
Yeah, and it's interesting even with their label. We have talked about this before, but for those who might not be aware, Mark, I wondered if you could tell the story, because you tell it really well and it relates as well, I guess, even to how you came up with the label of Generation Alpha. But we have the baby boomers, which is a pretty descriptive label, and then we move to the alphabet with X, Y, Z. Could you elaborate and tell our listeners, for those who haven't heard it before, how this generation came to be named Gen X?
Yes, well, it all comes from Canadian author Douglas Copeland, who was a bit of an observer of his times. And in 1991, he was born in 1961. So part of that whole gap generation there did not identify with the baby boomers, but was coming of age, seeing that there was a new generation that he was part of that were quite different to the boomers and there was no label, no one talking about them, no descriptions of them. And so he wrote a book called Generation X with the subtitle Tales for an Accelerated Culture, because the times were accelerating. The computer was starting to emerge in the 90s, from the 80s, in fact. And the times, the technology, the social context, the entertainment, MTV was emerging. You know, there was a sense that this was a new generation in a new era with new technologies and accelerated culture. But he said, you know, we're a generation lying low. We're not the protest generation getting out there transforming society like we saw the baby boomers do. Just call us X. You know, when someone doesn't want to sign their name, you just do an X. It's sort of a nondescript identity. That, he said, will be who we are, Generation X. And that anti-label, that nondescript label, created not only the label for Generation X, which has lasted now for these 40 years, but for every generation since Generation Y and Generation Z as well, and really gave influence to what we've continued on, labeling through alphabet themes, but using the Greek alphabet, Generation Alpha, etc. So, you know, the anti-label created a whole new labeling category. And I guess, you know, his point of Gen X, getting on with it, getting it done, not wanting fanfare, not wanting a label, is really now what we see of the generation. So is quite prescient.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a really interesting story to hear about. And like you said, the irony of ironies that he said, oh, don't give us a label, but then went to label the generations to come after as well, which is quite interesting. In this latest study, we investigated the top hopes and fears that each generation have. And it was interesting to see that for Gen X, the top hopes they have for their life are to have full financial freedom and independence, to travel and see the world, and to pursue interests and hobbies. And their top fears are that they won't have enough money to live comfortably, suffering a long-term illness, and not reaching their full potential. So I guess being in their kind of mid-years, mid-life stage, do you feel like any of those top hopes or fears were surprising to you, Mark, about this generation?
I think it sums up this life stage and this generation pretty well. You know, they were this youth generation. We can talk about some of the factors that shaped them, but have clearly stepped up into parenting, into leadership, into the economic life, and now are at the point where they say, you know, balance is important, time with family is important, relationships are important. So getting the finances nailed down, and I see even on the fifth on the list of hopes is to own the home. So it's not done yet for the Gen Xers in their 40s and in their 50s as well. But to free up time for those that they love and the hobbies and the interests, you know, it gets to a point in life where the career is on track and the finances are going fine. There's a trajectory there, but people say, you know, how are the relationships? How are the interests? Have I got enough of a curated life here, or is it just work, family, and commitments? And so getting the balance, getting the travel in, getting the joys of life as part of the lifestyle, not just paying for that lifestyle, that's really the life stage of the Gen Xer.
Yeah, it's really great to have this new fresh research and this new data about each generation. And in this report, we've got like an infographic overview of each generation based on some of the questions that we asked in this study, like we just talked about there, their top hopes for their life, their top fears as well. We talk about the platforms they go to upskill themselves, particularly online, as well as, you know, books and other forms of communication. We talk about qualities valued in the leader and most important. So lots of different things, I guess, around consumers and around employees. But one of the fun things we also did in this report is we included one of our most loved infographics about every generation, and it's our generations defined table. And even as part of that, when we did the little expose infographic on each generation, we even put in there some of the influential movies. And for Gen X, we've stated that it's Star Wars, Grease, and E.T. So people can kind of see whether that aligns with their perceptions. But even beyond influential movies or content, Mark, do you have any other insights to share with us about some of the key influences that did shape this generation?
Well, as the 1970s moved into the 1980s, it was a time of dramatic change in our society and in our world. And you mentioned some of those labels of the latchkey kids, just highlighting the rise of working parents and the costs of living, and a generation quite contrary to the generation that went before, that were a bit more urban and a bit more independent in terms of, you know, busyness of parents, and so had to make things sort things out themselves. You mentioned the divorce, and that was quite the phenomenal change as well in the formative years of the Gen Xer. In 1975 in Australia, there were 15,000 divorces. 1985, a decade later, 45,000 divorces. So a tripling in the number of divorces in that decade, right at the time that the Gen Xer was being raised and in their young years. So the impacts of that can't be overstated, and the shock to that. And so, you know, we saw a turnaround, even in the popular culture, from rock music, which was a bit more staid, to, as the Gen Xers came around, grunge music, this discordant music, this indie rock emerging that really, I guess, resonated with that sense of angst that was their lot as they were coming of age. The bands doing the rounds then, it was Nirvana, and people might remember the name Kurt Cobain, who tragically died young, and Pearl Jam, and these bands that were anything but pop. It was quite the pushback. It was quite the angsty music of the late 80s and 90s. The fashions, there was for a while there, fluorescent made a bit of a fashion statement, and hypercolor shirts, but that quickly gave way to the darker tones and to the grunge culture. Skateboard culture emerged in the 1980s. Again, it was a little bit contrarian in its approach. The bane of public transport users, if you see the tagging and that graffiti down the train lines, well, that really emerged in the 80s, this concept of tagging, and it was the Gen Xer, I guess, expressing a bit of pushback against society that started that whole thing. From emos to goths, we had a youth subculture that was a little darker, and even you think about that fine sport of skiing was literally carved up as snowboarding emerged, and it was the Gen Xer that sort of ushered in the start of that. So from the era of the yuppies, young up-and-coming professionals, to this grunge contrarian era, that's what we were seeing, partly in response to what was going on around the world. There was a sense in the mid-80s of maybe hope as some of the totalitarian regimes were starting to crumble. We saw by the late 1980s, the USSR coming to an end, and by 1991, the Berlin Wall had came down. But at the same time, hope in China for democracy and gathering at Tiananmen Square was crushed. And so it was an era where Gen Xers were trying to work out what is the new realities, what's going to stand and what's not. And I guess the popular culture, the music, the fashion, the subcultures really summed up their response to this era.
Yeah, it's really interesting to hear you paint that picture around even some demographic trends, even just hearing about the rate of divorce and the increase in that. Like, it's something to just say and skate over, but that has huge impacts on families. And I can imagine for a generation who've really saw the increase in that, would create a bit of skepticism and a response to that in all different ways of life, including, like you said, the fashions and the music and the sentiment of that generation. And I was just thinking, as you were describing them, even another quote that we often say, or that's come from you, Mark, I'm pretty sure, which is that every generation is a response to the one that went before. Do you feel like that's true as well of Gen X?
Yeah, it is. And the Gen X, in their own way, pushed back on some of the structures in their youth, just like the baby boomers are renowned for having done, but in a quite a different way. It was more an individualistic way rather than taking to the streets and transforming the social structures. And you know, they saw the start of computers, and to this day, in this study that we just ran, where we asked the Gen Xer, where do you go to learn new skills? You know, websites was number one. YouTube and Instagram were on the list as well, compared to the baby boomers, where books are still in the running. So the Gen Xer has adapted to the technology, and in many ways they ushered in the new technology and the PC era. But yeah, in a different way to what we see today. You know, social media has not been their thing on the whole, and they were using the computers as tools, but still connecting with the old world. Yeah, they were shaped, if we go back to the 1970s and 80s, with the Prime Minister being Malcolm Fraser and then Bob Hawke. It was still a structured and traditional time in a lot of ways, starting to change, but that was how it was. Ronald Reagan was the iconic president of the US in their time, and a generation that have seen the population double. It was 13 million as the Gen X was emerging, a national population now 26 million. So certainly a lot of change, a lot of trends, but a generation that have adapted to all of that, and now having thrown off some of the youthful angst, are now leaders of society in a pretty responsible but, you know, realistic way, leading in their own way, raising families and responsible leaders. But certainly the realities of a less than perfect upbringing and era give guidance to their pragmatism as they lead today.
Yeah, and it definitely seems aligned even with some of the words that this generation are often, or majority of them, are using to describe themselves. We did ask this question in the study of just the 2,000 people that we surveyed, which was representative of the Australian population by gender, by state, and by generation. And we tested a whole bunch of different words. There was, I think, at least 15 characteristics. And it was interesting to see that the majority of people in this generation were most likely to choose the words dependable, independent, and resilient, which to me, based on everything you've said so far, sounds like a pretty accurate attribution of qualities to them. Would you tend to agree, Mark?
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, those years of the uncertainty, it's really life stage stuff that young people have, where they test the system, where they push back on structures. But it was short-lived for the Gen Xer, and they had to get on with the economic realities of life that was put before them. They played to the rules of the game that the baby boomers had before them. They followed in their footsteps. And in many ways, by the time the Gen Xer had hit their 20s, they looked a lot like the diligent baby boomers that were just a few years ahead of them. They were getting jobs and paying their way. They were paying tax and making contributions. They were on a foothold in terms of property ownership and paying down that mortgage, and that forced savings offered some constraint to their spending. They were not the lifestyle generation. They were not the travel the world generation. They had jobs after all, and a mortgage and children as well. And so they got in and got it done. And I think that label of dependent and independent and resilient, and a sense of pride to that they have done it in that traditional way, is something that they wear as a badge of honor. And now they're reaping the rewards of that as they approach the midpoint in life, where they've got that financial security, generally speaking. Still some costs ahead, but that's where they are at, and they have done it themselves. They were the first generation that had to pay for their university degrees. They didn't get a let off with interest rates. It was quite high as they began. They went through the recession of 1991 and some other economic uncertainties as well. They saw unemployment that hit double digits in their time. So you had to work hard for a job, and you were grateful for it. If we were to put a dividing line in society, old approach, new approach, it would be after the Gen X. In other words, they're like the baby boomers. They got in and got it done. And we've seen, you know, changes to the attitudes and the focus and how it's done perhaps since the Gen Xer, and maybe for good reason. But the Gen Xer was the last of the old school generation, and dependable, independent, and resilient sums them up.
And it's interesting as well, I guess, because as you share these insights and talk about, yeah, these attributes that this generation identifies with and how appropriate it is to them and their times that have shaped them. You know, we talked about this even just in the introduction, that it's in the media, it's always the baby boomers, and then it's all millennials, and, you know, it's well, there's a generation in the middle there. But it's definitely seems like they're just the get it done generation. And maybe it's like a compliment in some ways, you know, like we're talking about the baby boomers and the millennials as the controversial ones for whatever the stereotypes are, but Gen X are like, oh, classic, us just forgotten about, but we're over here working hard, you know, doing the good things. So it's almost hopefully this generation can see that as maybe a bit of a compliment in some ways, even though they're a little bit of the forgotten generation. But we know that just based on their age at the moment, that they're in those mid-family years, mid-careers, and that mid-life stage. Do you think it's hard for generations or just people in general to kind of adapt. Like we make jokes about it. You know, I've made the joke, oh, millennials, not young person anymore. We've handed that down to the Gen Zs now. But do you think that's a kind of a characteristic of getting older and moving through those life stages that we can maybe lament the years of our youth or whatever? Do you reckon that's just a common human psyche thing as someone who observes social, you know, behavior and social research?
Yeah, I think for the Gen Xer, it's probably not a particularly reflective era or generation in that, you know, you just step out and you make it happen. And they're now at the point where they're living with sacrifice for the sake of the next generation, for their children, for thinking about their retirement so that they can, you know, fund that and not be reliant on others. Again, back to that independent term that they want to define them. And so, I think that they are content with their lot in life. That's what seemed to come through in this research, that they are happy with where they've landed. And indeed, if anything, it's looking forward where they think that sometimes the direction's not so great. There definitely are some generation gaps that emerge as they try to engage with their children. And it's sort of ironic for the Gen Xer, who was the PC generation, who emerged as Microsoft was emerging, as Apple as a company was emerging. We're pretty proud of their Apple Macintosh computers, or maybe it was the Commodore 64 or the Amstrad, their Atari game system. You know, they felt we are the generation that is ushering in technology. And now they struggle to work out what's the point of TikTok and how exactly does AI work and how do we help our children on that particular learning platform that they've got on the iPad. So there's a sense of irony around that they felt as Gen X as they were pretty computer and technology literate, indeed shaping the tech era, only to be left behind by their children. But that's just how life goes. And I think as a whole, it's a generation content with life, happy with how they've played the game, focused on the next generation, continuing to, I guess, lie low, not needing the fanfare, getting on with it, getting it done, making those net contributions or value adding, and happy to see that's bringing some outcomes for their children's generation.
Yeah, it's a lovely way to describe them, and such, again, so many great things to be said of this generation who just seem to be getting in there and getting it done and moving through the life stages with a lot of poise and contentment. As we think about the future on this Future Report podcast, Mark, what do you think is ahead for this generation as we look to the future? We talked in the previous episode about baby boomers and retirement that's ahead for them. That's, I guess, a few years away still for the Gen Xers. But what do you feel is ahead for Gen X?
Well, they're making their way right through their 50s at the oldest edge. And so that means grandchildren are on the horizon for Gen X. And probably it's hard for every generation to get their head around the changing life stages. The years go faster, the decades fly faster at an accelerating rate, you know, relative to the time that we've lived. It's just a numerical reality there. And so I think that the Gen X are thinking of themselves as grandparents, starting to think seriously about retirement, thinking about therefore helping their children into property or into that next phase of their life, becoming empty nesters, and suddenly thinking through what they do with that home that they have, and also thinking about as they. And they're in the peak of work at the moment, of course. They're a fifth of the population, but they're more than a quarter of the workforce, so they're the backbone of it. But clearly that's not going to always be the case. And over the decade ahead, some will start to downshift from those full-time roles, and therefore thinking about as they curate their week, what else is part of that? What might be the other contributions or time use that they can add in? So this is what's ahead for the generation, as well as, of course, hopefully, you know, shaping the future, having the impacts. They have leverage. They have finance, experience, leadership opportunities, roles in society. And I think it's a generation that won't finish up and hand over those reins without making good stewardship of these opportunities. So I think that some big impacts for the Gen X are yet to be seen, and many are planning for that. So I think, you know, good decades ahead for the Gen Xer. As always with the Gen Xers, they're not going to fly the flag on it, but watch this space because I think they'll make some contributions yet.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we open with this quote that we put in the report that we shared. And again, it's just a bit of a tribute to Gen X. So we said, you know, Gen X, like their non-descript label, have an understated visibility in society, but bring massive influence across different areas of life, economically, demographically, politically, and organizationally. And they're having big impacts and doing it in a very humble way. So props to anyone who's listening who's a Gen X. Props to you, Mark, as a Gen X yourself. Thanks so much for your time today and for your expertise.
Thanks, Ash.
And if you'd like to stay up to date with our latest insights, including our latest Generations Defined report, you can always subscribe to the podcast to hear more about it. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com to access these full resources. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.